to all estates' inevitable losses. To herdsman rot, to ploughman hapless seasons. To sailors, it brings storms. To cities, civil treason.
But for one child, the comet was not the least bit frightening. For him, it was a thing of wonder. Like all of us, Edmund Halley was born curious.
Help!
He was lucky to have a father who encouraged and nurtured his curiosity, buying him the best scientific instruments, and even funding his expedition to make the first accurate star map of the Southern Hemisphere. Halley dropped out of Oxford when he was 20 and sailed to St. Helena, an island below the equator off the west coast of Africa.
Pounds and pounds.
Problem was, nobody told Halley that the weather on St. Helena was generally lousy. It took him 12 frustrating months to observe enough southern stars to make a complete map. The gods and heroes of ancient Greece were now joined by the mythic figures of a new world and age. A toucan, a compass, a bird of paradise. When Halley came home with the other half of the sky, his map created a sensation. Now merchants and explorers could navigate by the stars visible anywhere on Earth. At the time, the Royal Society of London was the world's clearinghouse of scientific discovery. Its motto, Nullius in Verba, sums up the heart of the scientific method. It's Latin for see for yourself. In other words, question authority. Halley's star maps caught the attention of the Society's curator of experiments. I'd show them to you if I could, but no portrait of Robert Hooke exists from his time. Only the verbal descriptions of his contemporaries. They called him mean, bent, ugly. He was possibly the most inventive person who ever lived. And despite his appearance, he was the most sought-after party guest in all of London. Why? Hooke's insatiable curiosity encompassed absolutely everything. Hooke discovered a little cosmos, and we still call it by the name he gave it,